What's up, everybody? Murph for TPSmethod.com and EliteFTS.com back with part three in the Dave Kirschen's Tales of Glory series. So we wrapped up last time talking about the miserable weight cut that he had and the not having any ability to recover leading into the WPO prep. So today we're going to talk about his performance at the WPO.
Mm-hmm. So now I should go back a little bit because I really had no reason to do 165 at this point.
You know,
the
WPO. Yeah,
well, the WPO was like my own, not in terms of practicality.
Right.
I didn't really have to.
Right, because I could have weighed what you weighed.
I couldn't weigh what I weighed. It was a coefficient meet. I could have gone in at really any weight class I wanted as long as I would be above the coefficient. I could have gone. And I probably would have had a better chance if I didn't make the weight cut a big part of the thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it was about the challenge.
Right.
You know, it was about just doing something really fucking hard.
Yeah.
So that last weight cut was probably the worst weight cut of my life, by far. The initial weight came off pretty easy. The first 89 pounds came off pretty easy, and the last 10, that was tough. I usually use hot baths to get down that final, final few pounds, and usually I go kind of five on, five off. Mm-hmm. I don't tolerate heat very well,
yeah.
But I develop a sweat pretty early.
Do you use the whole straw through the water and stuff too, or you just stay in the tub?
I just stay in the tub. I do break a sweat pretty quickly, so I can get by on that. And with that, I'm about minimum investment.
I'm just not saying a word about that.
Yeah, with hot baths, I don't recover from heat very well, so I try to use it as sparingly as possible. So I found five off, five on to be a good. Mentally, I was making it to about three.
Nice.
And that was where I was throwing in the towel.
Check it out.
I just couldn't break. And what I realized was, I just didn't fucking care as much. You know, and getting back to what I had said earlier is that, you know, it's you really got to want it for a cut like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was realizing during the cut, I didn't want it that much anymore.
Right.
It wasn't any harder than it normally was. Like, my weight wasn't any higher than it was last time. Yeah, I just wasn't as invested.
I did it. I don't need to do it again.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
So what happened? Did you make the weight?
Made the weight.
Okay.
Made 164.
So you made 164, and then we went to the warm-up room, and how did we feel?
Well, obviously, you recomp after that because it's a 24-hour weigh-in.
Right. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I just ate a ton of shit and blew it up.
Pickle juice?
Yeah, pickle juice, VA, raw, Pedialyte, just whatever salty.
A lot of salt, a lot of fluid.
I do IV, so I immediately after I weighed in, I went to one of those little IV places that they've opened up now.
Little IV place.
Mm-hmm.
How many bags? Two?
Two bags, 1,000 bags.
Also, pro powerlifter secret kits.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of dirty shit goes on. At least now you can get an IV from somebody that's a professional instead of having your boy do it with a fucking harpoon. Thank God I lifted in the 308s and didn't cut weight.
Yeah, when your training partner comes at you with a needle like this.
Yeah. You're. Anyway, so you hung a couple bags, you pickle juiced it up, and
did
the recomp, and you got the weight back up to what?
Got the weight back about 185.
So isn't that really kind of insane that people do all this work and they put their body through this for nothing?
Nothing tangible.
Personal, right.
Nothing
tangible. You know, people look at athletes and they're getting paid all this money, and you know, people in our sport challenge just as much and they sacrifice just as much, and there's virtually no compensation, but it's a personal
thing. I've developed a theory about that, and it sort of explains why we're willing to put so much into something that really doesn't give us anything on paper, and maybe we'll end with this in this section. I have a feeling that the people who are really successful in life probably aren't successful because of what they could attain materially, right? I think they're just fucking wired to do that.
Yeah.
I think successful people, whatever they're successful in, whether it's something that makes them money or not, whether it's business or sport, whatever, pro athlete, us, I think people make it to that level because they just don't know any other way, and that's just how they're going to approach anything.
Yeah.
And I think people acquire that level of success because something's driving them to put the work in. Not to achieve what they're trying to achieve, but it's really the work that they're doing.
Something's driving you.
And I think that's what generally separates.
And people sometimes don't know what it is that's driving them.
No. I didn't know for 23 years.
It took me 51 years to figure it out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, when I say 23, I'm just using my career. Who knows what I was thinking of before that.
Right.
But yeah, it took me a long time to realize why I was in it. And part of putting that work into that that previous meet that I bombed in, it was just about the work.
Yeah.
But I had to cross a certain
but
threshold.
Something was making you do the work.
Something was making me do the work.
It was about
the
work, but something was making you do the work. If you didn't have that internal drive, you wouldn't be doing the work.
Right.
Because the fucking work is hot.
And we're going to get to that. Yep. We're going to get to that because I found out what it is.
Well, let's go. We got 4 minutes.
Fear.
Fear of what?
I don't know. What do you got? Right?
Fear of failure. Fear of what? I mean, so.
I don't know. But powerlifting gives you the opportunity to conquer fear.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So weights that you're afraid of.
If you want to knock 800 pounds and you sit down with it and stand up, I tell this to people all the time, and then, you know, you're in a board meeting or a meeting with your boss and your boss is pissed at you, like, your mind's like, fuck you, dude, I just squatted 800 pounds.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You don't scare me.
But you got to work. But I think it's not, again, we're going back to the accomplishment. I don't think it's about the accomplishment. I think it's about what you did to get there. That's what really puts that. That's what really gives you that perspective.
Meant in terms,
yeah.
I meant in terms of, like, you know, getting rid of the fear.
I understand. I'm just trying to, you know, make sure everyone gets what we're talking about, because I think it's hard to get this when you're early in your career because you're still thinking numbers.
Right.
And I think that.
Yeah, we talked about the other day. I'm going to go back. I'm going to do another bench meet at some point soon. And you know, we talked about how the numbers that I'm going to lift are probably going to be embarrassing, but. I don't fucking care. I just
no, because you've gotten over that fear.
I just want to.
You've gotten over the fear of underperforming in front of a crowd. Right. That's one of the first you got to get over.
Yeah, I just want to get up. I just want to get up to a meet. You know, because you said you don't need powerlifting. You need to, how you
I don't need to compete. I don't need to do lifts in front of judges.
I feel like I need to compete.
Yeah, and maybe
you know. I kind of feel that way. You know, so I don't care what I lift. I'm going to lift the most I can lift on that day. And I used to be like, well, I can't do this meet. I'm not ready for it. I can't. You know, I got to squat this much, or else it's, you know, no point in doing it.
So
like, fuck it.
So what I realized was, if you go down the list of all the possible fears you could have about powerlifting, mm-hmm. I checked off every one.
Well,
right?
Such as?
Fear of failure. Fear of failing publicly. Mm-hmm. Right? WPO is the biggest stage in the world. I just screwed the fucking pooch. Didn't affect me.
Yeah.
Right, so I got over that fear.
Yeah.
I got over the fear of heavy weights.
Yep.
Especially with training with fucking Skiba and Delphi. I don't scare anything now.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Can you get 11 blue bands on each side, please?
3 blue bands of 4 pounds, 400 pounds. Yeah, whatever. Not scared of weight anymore.
Yep.
Not scared of injuries anymore. We're both fucked up.
Yep.
We both have pain.
Yep.
Pain's an old friend at this point.
I mean, if you're in this as long as we have been, something right. hurts all the time.
So after all that, what's the last fear you could possibly have about power?
That it's going to come to an end.
Ah, there you go.
Right?
Walking away.
Is that it?
That was it.
We didn't discuss that.
That was it.
Walking away.
That was the last one. And I realized, looking back, I conquered every single fear I could possibly have about the sport, except that one. And over the course of that last prep, I realized, like, yeah, the fear of walking away is the only fucking thing keeping me in.
Yeah.
So maybe I should address that fear.
Just walk away. Right? Just like your monkey said, just walk away. Kids won't get that one either.
Yeah, I think we're at a minute. I think we're good.
All right, so we're going to end it there. Dave put a little bit of wisdom in there for you. I'm going to cut it because the camera doesn't want to record more than 10 minutes, and nobody wants to watch a fucking video that's more than 10 minutes. So we're going to be back next week, and we're going to talk about training and how to properly implement a conjugate system and some of the mistakes people make, and we'll see if we can wrap that up in 10 minutes. What do you think?
Let's give it a shot.